Well, good morning and Merry Christmas. Man, it's great to have you guys out today. How many have already opened up presents this morning? All right, good, terrific. How many did it yesterday? All right, how many of you still have presents to do when you go home? All right, great. Well, I hope you just have a wonderful day, and it's our honor to have you with us on Christmas Sunday morning. Thank you for coming out and being here. Hey, I want to introduce a couple of folks that you may not know. I want to introduce to you the bishops, all right? Chris's mom and dad, all right? There's Chris. And there's Chris. All right. And there's Dan behind the piano, all right? They're up from Southern California. They have been pastors in Southern California for a few decades. And we've been praying for Dan over the past year. He's had some heart challenges. And so he's kind of been out of the saddle for about 8 months. And so this is kind of their first time engaging in some ministry. And so we're excited to have them with us today. We're glad they're up seeing their grandkids for Christmas. We know they don't care about Chris for Christmas, but the grandkids are wonderful. No, that's not true. But it's our pleasure to have them with us today. We had a grand time last night, all right, and it was a lot of fun. In fact, for anybody who, when you leave today, there is a bowl of Pastor's Peppermint Hershey Kisses. So grab one on your way out, all right? I hate chocolate, so you got peppermint, all right? But it's what the store had. So, but anyway, just a little something to sweeten you up for the day. We hope you'll take advantage of that. Let me highlight a couple of announcements and then a few prayer requests, and we will get engaged in our worship today. We're kind of streamlining things for this morning. If you are visiting with us today, you honor us by being here. And there is a communication card in the pew in front. We'd love for you to fill it out. And next week through the mail, we'll send you information about the church. We promise not to beat on the door or bother you on the phone, but through the mail, put some information in your hand. And I don't do this. You can ask our radio folks, what I'm about to do, I never do. I never like to make visitors feel like they're being pointed out, okay? But it's Christmas. And so I have a gift, actually. For folks who, if this is your first time here, I would love for you to just quickly raise your hand. I'm not going to make you say a word. Okay? Yeah, no, get out of here. All right, from out of country, all right, and as well as out of state. So who else do I have back here? It's not your first time. Not yours either. Okay.
You said your first time
here. No, your first time here is Christmas Sunday. Yeah, no. Okay, that's one that qualifies. After surgery and after stabbing, hospitals and surgery deserves one. All right. One of my favorite all-time books, all right? And I think you'll find it very, very enjoyable. I was given a gift today, all right? This is what's really cool about this. You'll find out it goes along with the theme of the sermon today, and they didn't even know it, but there's a wood craftsman sitting right up here on the front, and he brought to me this beautiful wood-carved pen, all right? And here's what makes this part of the sermon today, is this wood is olive wood from Bethlehem, all right? So that's pretty cool. That is beautiful, and Shelly got one up here too, all right? So thank you so very much, but that's very special. All right, there's really not much going on around here this week, all right? So please pay attention to the bulletin. There's not any youth group activities. There's not any men's Bible studies. There's not any women's Bible studies. So the regular things that normally happen in a week are not happening between Christmas and New Year's. We will have folks in the office. The hours may be limited somewhat, so if you need something, you probably ought to call to make sure that we are here. We do have two memorial services here on Wednesday, so we would appreciate you remembering both of those families, the Denier families from out by near Biola, and then many of you are familiar with the last Clovis West student who unfortunately took his life. His name is Enzo Fernando, and that service is going to be here at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. So please be praying for the Fernando family. I spent a couple of hours with them on Friday afternoon, and what a challenge that they are going through, and what a challenge for the Clovis West community as well. So please just be in prayer for both of those services on Wednesday. Jordan Paulsgraf is going to be having surgery on Tuesday. She's our high school student, and this will be her fifth surgery as a result of that mass that was on her rib cage. They were hoping maybe the last one was it, but they do need at least one more. It's an outpatient. She goes in the morning. She'll go home hopefully in the afternoon or early evening, so be praying for her. Doug Brobst is with us from Southern California. He's here with his sister and his dad today. And just found out that Doug is going to be having surgery down in San Diego on Wednesday. So would appreciate you remembering to pray for him. I shouldn't ask it this way, but may I share briefly your story? All right. I'm not sure what I would do if he said no, but actually, Doug's pretty regular here. That's just they normally are in the 8 o'clock service, so some of you don't normally get to see the Brobst. But Doug actually has the very same thing my mother had, all right, alpha-1 antitrypsin, and it's very, very rare. And that was kind of a Wednesday night Bible study thing where we said have them test, and they did, and they got on it fairly early. So he's been able to be part of some protocols that are very new. And he's been doing well with it, but there are complications which some come with that. And so they're going to try to fix those complications this coming week. And so his dad told me the surgery was kind of like dental floss. They're going to go in here, and they're going to go in here, and the doctor said they're going to kind of do this to clear out some challenges that are there. So please be praying for Doug and for his family as they have that surgery this coming Wednesday. So those, Larry Baumeister, Rose is a regular attender, part of our 8 o'clock crowd as well, and Rose is spending this Christmas morning at Clovis Community Hospital in ICU with her husband. Larry collapsed at his place of business the first of last week. They thought he had had a stroke. It turns out that he has pneumonia and meningitis. He has not been responsive since Tuesday. I did chat with her. I'm going to see them right after the service today. I talked to Rose last night via text, and she said they did take him off the intubator, and he's breathing on his own. And so that's one step of progress in this treatment. So please, please be praying for them as they're going through this process right now. So Larry Gallett, got to spend some time with him this past week. He's under hospice care, we understand now, and but had a great visit with Larry. Just continue to lift him and his family up in your prayers. I know they would appreciate that so very, very much. I'm going to ask our ushers to come and prepare to wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. Gentlemen, if you'd come, please, and would you join with me as we pray? Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the life that you share with us. We thank you for what this season represents, for what this day means to the world. But I think, Father, most of all, I want to say thank you for what this day means to you. Because without your plan and without your purpose that you wanted that plan to accomplish, we would not know anything about Christmas. And Father, Christmas would not be any big deal if it wasn't for Easter. And so when we celebrate the one, we have to remember the other. And so today we are so grateful for the birth of your Son, so that the crucifixion of your Son could occur, so that my debt of sin could be paid for, that which separated us from you could be dealt with, could be bridged and gapped. And then we thank you, Father, for the resurrection of Jesus Christ, so that the life that we still live in this world, we do not have to live by ourselves, we do not have to live on our own. But Father, you choose that once you forgive us to come take residence within us and to do for us what we could never do for ourselves. Live a godly life. Express the fruit of the Spirit of joy and peace and goodness and love and kindness. And Father, this is a day which causes us to slow down from the harried, hectic pace of life and reflect on the way we live. And Father, whether we're living more for ourselves or living more for you, of whether there's more of us and less of you being seen and evidenced in our life on a daily basis. And Father, we can do some accounting work. we could do some examination and say, okay, Lord, as we come to a wrap-up of this year and we begin to start anew, I want there to be a lifestyle that shows less of me and more of you. And so, Father, I pray that's the desire of many of our hearts this day. Thank you for the privilege of giving and sharing. Thank you for your gracious generosity to us, and I trust that we will be as gracious with our generosity back to your kingdom work. And so we say thanks. We commit this to you in the awesome, wonderful, incredible, lovely name of your Son, the one who was our Savior, Lord, and life. His name is Jesus. Amen. When we come on a day like today, we can't help but think about the baby born in a stable. And most of us know that stable was in a place called Bethlehem. And what I hope you'll do today is you'll connect the baby and Bethlehem to the bread. Because that's the full story. Paul Harvey was famous for doing a radio broadcast called The Rest of the Story. And he would tease you with the first part of the story, which was exciting, but he would leave you with a cliffhanger. And Christmas without Easter would be just a cliffhanger. It requires both of them together. And so this morning, on Christmas Day, we're going to be sharing in communion. I know we have several of our kids in here who normally are in Sunday school when we share communion. And parents, this is going to be strictly up to you. You didn't know about this in advance, so you can whisper to each other over the next few minutes. I've had parents come to me over the years and say, Pastor, what age can our children start taking communion? And my answer to that is been the same all these years, and that is, if they know Jesus, they're old enough to take communion. And so that will strictly be up to you. So let me give a few directions before we get started with the communion meditation that our associate pastor, Mark Addis, there you are, is going to come up and share in just a moment. But over the next few minutes, once I invite Mark up, there are some folks in our church who are going to come up, and they are going to pick up the trays of bread and the trays of the cup, and they're going to distribute those, just kind of like offering. They're going to go up and down the rows, and as it comes by you, take each of the elements that you choose. Take the bread, take the cup, and hold it until after the meditation is finished. And then we will eat together as a family. We will share together and celebrate together as an entire church family. And just remember, this bread is the symbol of the body of Jesus Christ that was birthed in Bethlehem but crucified on a cross, wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. And the cup is a picture of his blood. It's a symbol. It represents the fact that he shed his blood for us. And the brokenness of his body and the shedding of his blood was the payment required to forgive us of our sin. And the resurrected life is the presence of Jesus once our sin has been forgiven that now comes to live within us. So if this, as a child, might be your first time to share in communion, I can't think of a better day than a Christmas Sunday morning, falling on Christmas, that you get to share with your family in this. And so, kids, do it. I want you to take the bread. I want you to take the cup. Hold it. Wait till everybody gets it. And then we will give you directions after prayer about when to eat the bread and drink the cup. But you are certainly welcome to join us. If you are visiting with us today, you do not have to be a member of New Hope to share in communion. The only requirement is that you are a member of God's family, and you and God are the only two who know that. And so you are welcome to be a part of our communion meditation and celebration this morning. So if the folks who have volunteered or were requested, if you would come forward, please, and assist us in sharing. So, gentlemen, would you come forward?
Good morning. Actually, one of my favorite songs at this time of year is Silent Night. It's a slow but beautiful tune that accompanies the words that describe a peaceful scene at a manger the night that Jesus came into the world. You can easily conjure up the image of a small baby sleeping in heavenly peace. But it was a quiet before the storm of his life. A life that shook up the world forever. And as we prepare for communion today, Christmas Day, You might be thinking to yourself, isn't this slightly more fitting for an Easter morning? The reenactment of the Last Supper that Jesus had with his disciples prior to his crucifixion. But it's important to connect the birth of a baby boy with the final days before Jesus was executed. The night that Jesus came from prayer when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane was the same night that he was arrested and tried. But that was another silent night, because Jesus used no words to defend or save himself. The man who as a baby lay silent in a manger now remains silent through the evening of accusations and harassment. He had plenty of opportunity to speak when he was questioned by the Roman authorities. After all, he'd spoken out against the hypocrisy of the religious leaders. He'd spoken in defense of the outcast and the rejects, in defense of tax collectors, prostitutes, and adulterers. He spoke regularly to his father in prayer. But when he had the opportunity to speak in his defense, there were no words, only silence. He had the ability to call on incredible power to come in his defense. He could have cried out for vengeance against his enemies, but he remained silent, silent and acutely aware of the plan of his father. God sent an angel to speak just as Abraham was about to sacrifice Isaac, his son. But on this day, God remained silent. There was no angel. Why? Because it was foretold in Isaiah 53:6 that the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Isaiah goes on in verse 7 to say, he was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. So today, as we celebrate the birth of Jesus, we should bring ourselves closer to him through communion, the blood and body of Christ. We celebrate Jesus as a gift from God, the greatest of all gifts, wrapped as an ordinary man, but there was nothing ordinary about him. As Bethlehem bustled with people during the time of his birth, and as Jerusalem was brimming with people celebrating the Passover at the time of his death, there was an underlying peace and silence in the busyness. This Christmas, take a moment to be silent. Give thanks for the greatest Christmas gifts from our Father. Mercy, kindness, peace, joy, and gladness. Merry Christmas.
There was a Jewish lady by the name of Mrs. Rosenberg who, several decades ago, was stranded late one night at a fashionable resort community. You have to remember, this was a time when prejudice ran very public and very high still in this country. This was a resort that did not rent to Jews. The desk clerk looked down at his book and said, sorry, ma'am, no room. This hotel is full. The Jewish lady said, but your sign out front says you have vacancies. And he stammered, and then he finally said bluntly, ma'am, the deal is this. We do not admit Jews. Now, if you'll simply go to the other side of town. Mrs. Rosenberg stiffened noticeably and said, I'll have you know, I've converted to your religion. The desk clerk was taken back a moment and said, oh yeah? Well, let me give you a test. How was Jesus born? Mrs. Rosenberg replied, to a virgin named Mary in a little town called Bethlehem. Very good, said the clerk. Tell me more. Mrs. Rosenberg said, he was born in a manger. That's right, the clerk said. And why was he born in a manger? Mrs. Rosenberg said loudly, because a jerk like you in a hotel wouldn't give a Jewish lady a room for the night. Love that lady. You see, we know the story of Bethlehem and what happened there. But of all the cities and the towns and villages in Palestine, why did God choose an unheard of hamlet, a small little town as Bethlehem, for the birth of the greatest figure ever to enter into human history? If a site selection committee had been appointed, the name of Bethlehem probably would have never made the list. There were all kinds of important reasons to favor another location. If you're from Oklahoma, choosing Bethlehem would have been like choosing Dill, Oklahoma. Yeah, where Dad was born. Just a small little hamlet. You see, the city of Hebron, for example, would have been a much better community, a much better selection by a committee. I mean, it had an important role in Hebrew history. Abraham and Jacob and Joseph and later David had close associations with Hebron. And the name literally means to team up or friendship. Wouldn't that have been a perfect place for God to become a man in a place that means team up? On the other hand, Jerusalem might have been the most logical choice. 611 times the city of Jerusalem is mentioned in the Old Testament. For centuries, from the day David captured it from the Jebusites to make it his city, Jerusalem was the center of religious and cultural and civil life in Israel. The magnificent Temple of Solomon, the greatest building we've been told that was ever built, was there, and the royal palace. A site selection committee would be hard-pressed to find reasons to deny Jerusalem as a great city for Jesus to be born in, the privilege of welcoming a king. But Jerusalem failed to make the cut. What about Nazareth? I mean, another logical favorite. It was the home of Mary and Joseph. It offered the most inconvenience. We would have never had the donkey trip, all right? We would have never had the late night need for a motel room. Life could have gone on as usual. Joseph, Mary, Jesus, surrounded by relatives and good neighbors. No interruptions in the daily flow of activity. So why Bethlehem? Well, by the ancient prophet's own words, Prophet Micah, chapter 5, verse 2, Bethlehem was small among the clans of Judah. And for whatever reason, Bethlehem never rose to a position of prominence in its entire history. Two events stand out in its history, though. Small town, not well known, not greatly located. But two things of great significance happened there. Number one, it was here that Israel's great and ideal king, poet, and hero, King David, it's in Bethlehem he was born. It's here that he was a shepherd boy. It was here he was anointed. Number two, before that, the most beautiful love story of all time occurred in Bethlehem. The story of Naomi and Ruth and Boaz. If you've never taken the time personally to read the little book of Ruth in the Old Testament, you owe yourself that privilege. It is a marvelous, marvelous story. But apart from those two events, people came in and out of Bethlehem with no sense of destiny. Excuse me. This notion of obscurity is captured by a verse from one of our favorite songs that we sing during this Christmas season. Let me remind you of the words. O little town of Bethlehem, how still we see you lie. Above the deep and dreamless sleep, the silent stars go by. Yet in your dark street shineth the everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight. Bethlehem's beginning dates back to the dim past of history. It had lain still in a deep and a dreamless sleep for nearly 2,000 years before shepherds showed up to see a baby lying in a manger. Why should they wake Bethlehem now? Well, let's look at the name itself. Bethlehem is a Hebrew word, and the name literally means, are you ready? House of bread. You're absolutely correct. Who said that? Oh, outstanding. Okay, hold on. Take him a book back there. All right, he gets a book. gets a book. Yeah, wave when he gets back there, all right? Yeah, it literally means house of bread. Isn't that cool? Bethlehem, the baby, bread. The whole story was there at his birth. You see, I think there are three significant things behind being born of Bethlehem. House of bread identifies with the common man. Jesus was not born in the house of royalty, nor in the house of riches, nor in the house of celebrity. Jesus was not born in Jerusalem or Rome or Athens or Alexandria. He was born in Bethlehem. Jesus was not born in any political, commercial, cultural, educational, or socially significant city of the day. When Micah, that Old Testament prophet, foretold the birth of Jesus hundreds of years before it occurred, he emphasized its lack of significance in the world. But you, Bethlehem, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from old, ancient times. Bethlehem, the house of bread. Bread is one of life's most common things. God wanted his son available to every one of us, rich or poor, well-known or obscure. His birth was announced to shepherds, the common man, not to King Herod. His cradle was a manger, an animal's feeding trough in a lowly stable. You see, you don't have to be rich to know him. You don't have to be well-known or popular to know him. Just be you. Jesus came not for the religious and those who thought they were perfect, but he came for the ones who knew things were not right. He came for the ones who would be aware of their need. Are you aware of your need? Bethlehem and the babe have come for you. Number two, Christ was born in Bethlehem to satisfy our spiritual hunger. Jesus said about himself in John chapter 6, verse 35, I am the what? Bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry. He who believes in me will never be thirsty. Bread is a great comparison to our Lord because he satisfies and he gratifies and he strengthens us spiritually just as bread does for us physically. Many are eating at the wrong table. Isaiah chapter 55 verse 2 says, why spend money on what is not bread and your labor on what does not satisfy? Listen, listen to me, double listen. Eat what is good, and your soul will delight in the richest affair. You see, it's easy to get caught up in searching for the meaning of life and the wrong things, because there's a lot of things that bring momentary and temporary happiness, but only Christ satisfies this eternal dimension of our human spirit. Christ is all the soul of man needs for spiritual satisfaction. That fact that Jesus was born in the house of bread gives us confidence that God indeed wants to choose us to be his children, no matter how insignificant we may seem to ourselves or to the world around us. And last of all, Christ was born of Bethlehem to show us that each of us must choose the Savior for ourselves. You can't choose him. He's not yours because your father chose him. He's not yours because your best friend chose him. He can only be yours because you choose him. You see, if one person eats a meal, it doesn't satisfy anybody else's hunger. If I eat and you don't, you're still hungry. By the way, have you already had breakfast? I haven't either. I'm hungry. The Bible says that we are all to be partakers of one bread, and that one bread is Jesus Christ. He's the only bread that offers life, and the decision to receive him is a personal one, and he invites each of us to partake of his presence today. I can't imagine a better day to be spiritually born on than on Christmas Day. And I hope you'll take the privilege and the quietness of the next few moments in your heart, and as the worship team's going to come back, and come on up, guys, take your place. I'm going to tell one last story, and then they're going to close us out with a song. And in this final prayer and song today, what a great time for you in the quietness of your heart to partake of the bread of life. Invite him to come live within you, forgive you of your sin, come live within you, and give you a purpose beyond what you could imagine for your life to have. Years ago, Harry Reasoner. If you're 50 or older, you probably remember him, okay? But Harry Reasoner, news commentator, he wrote a piece about Christmas for the show 60 Minutes. And in it, he said, the basis of this tremendous burst of buying things and gift giving and parties and near hysteria is a quiet event that happened a long, long time ago. You can say that in all societies there's always been a midwinter festival, and that many of the trappings of our Christmas are almost violently pagan. But you come back to the central fact of the day, the birth of God on earth. It leaves us only three ways of accepting Christmas. One is cynically. It's a time to make money and endorse the making more money. Two is graciously. The appropriate attitude of non-believers who wish their fellow citizens all the joys their beliefs entitle them to. And three is we can do this reverently. If this is the anniversary of the appearance of the Lord of the universe as a helpless babe of Bethlehem, then this is an important day. It's a startling idea that a virgin was chosen by God to bear his son as a way of showing love and concern. The story has magnificent appeal. Almost nobody has seen God, and almost nobody has any real idea of what he is like, but everyone has seen babies, and most people like them. If God wanted to be loved, if God wanted to intimately be a part of our life, he has moved correctly. For the experience of birth and family is our most intimate and precious experience. So if people are only touched once a year, the touch is still worth it. Maybe on some given Christmas, and hopefully this one, some final quiet morning, the touch will take hold of you. The Bethlehem, the babe, and the bread. It's what this day is all about.